Members, please be seated.
我們現在夠座。
We have a quorum and it is the appointed time for the meeting.
好了，自上次會議。
Since the last meeting, we have had a few papers issued. After the regular meeting on the 15th of March, we have received a total of 18 information papers, and these have been listed in the agenda. As for the next meeting, there will be three items for discussion. Number one, allowing access to franchised buses for persons carrying compressed oxygen cylinders for self-medical use. Number two, reconstruction of Pekok Pier on Lama Island. And number three, measures to increase provision of car parking spaces. Members, what do you think about this proposed agenda for the next meeting? Mr. Charles Mok, Chairman, I'd like you to confirm with the administration, why is it that we do not have an item on fare increase? I think this is a little weird because every time it seems they are proposing some fare increases. Well, that's an ironic remark only, right? Mr. Tony Chair, thank you. Chair, the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macao Bridge has been commissioned for half a year. I'd like to ask the administration to update the panel on what the administration is doing with regard to the utilization, traffic flow, people flow, and also the cross-boundary concourse, and what facilitation measures have been put in place, and also the signages. Since half a year has passed, I'd like to hear from the administration what they propose to do in these few areas in the future. Thank you. Okay. That's fine. Mr. Charles Mok is proposing to discuss fare increases, and you are proposing to discuss the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macao Bridge measures. All right. Understood. If there is nothing else. Yes, Dr. Helena Wong, Chairman. Can I please ask you to let the administration know that when we take up the issue of car parking spaces, they should supply a paper on the central Kowloon route that would be built and which would necessitate the demolition of the car park there. And also, are you going to also discuss the smart parking systems? Okay, so you have indicated that you'd like to mention the central Kowloon route and also smart parking systems. We haven't got the paper yet, and you are saying that we should ask them to include those in the paper. Okay, I'll tell the administration about this. Mr. Lam Chek Ting, may I refer to the list of outstanding items? One item has to do with anti-north traffic congestion. There will be development of anti-northeast, and it will lead to an increase of 200,000 people going to anti-north, and I believe the traffic volume will be very much inflated in future. I'd like to ask the administration to come along because, like Mr. Wong Kwok Kin, he lives in Sheng Shui and he will experience a lot of problems later. I'd like to urge the administration to come forward to discuss these as soon as possible because then they may have to take the measures only after a few years and then that might not be in tandem with population increase. I think you're referring to number 18 in the list of outstanding items. Okay, we'll ask the administration to try to advance that. Anything else? Mr. Yu Siwing, Chairman. Recently, about the XRL Hong Kong section, every day the patronage is stabilizing at 50,000 to 60,000. And there is a rumor in a way that the MTRCL is saying that if people go to Futian and Shenzhen, people do not have to buy tickets in advance and people can just board right there. I think this is the concern of the community. I'd like to know whether indeed that has been proposed for Shenzhen. Can we ask the MTRCL or the administration to come and explain and also try to advance this? Well, this may have to be taken up by Mr. Frankie Yick at the Railway Subcommittee, all right? Mr. Lam Chek Ting? Chairman, I'd like to make another proposal, and that is also for the advance of an item. I'd like to ask about the operation situation of the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macao Bridge after commissioning, because actually the motorists are telling us that it's a really very pleasant journey because few people use the bridge. I'd like to talk about the cost effectiveness of that bridge, please. All right. We'll reflect your views to the officials. All right. If there's nothing else, we have two items on the agenda today. First, matters arising from the meeting on the 15th of March. Two motions were not processed at the last meeting because of a lack of time, and we need to process them today. The first one is moved by Honorable Jeremy Tam, Tanya Chan, Elvin Yeung, and Dr. KK Kwok. The motion is printed on paper CB4656-01. Please put it on the screen. Right, it's on the screen. Can I ask Mr. Jeremy Tam to move the motion? Can you raise your hand? Yes, Mr. Tam is over here. Please. Since after fare increase, owners may adjust the higher fee upwards, and this will not increase any income for the drivers. And also in 2017, there was already a fare increase of about 10%. Therefore, we are going to object to the application for 20% fare increase. We would ask the administration to concentrate on increasing or enhancing the quality of service and improve situations of taking an indirect route, higher refusal, and a bad, poor attitude of drivers, and also charging excessive fare, etc. And also, the administration should make use of the LPG stations better so as to reduce the queuing time. Can we use the electronic voting system? If you are ready, please sit according to your own seating number and we can proceed to vote now. Please cast your vote, members. Please check your vote. Voting shall now stop and the results are displayed. 16 present, 12 for, 3 against. The motion is carried. Second motion, moved by Mr. Gary Fan. Mr. Fan, please move your motion. Thank you. Since the application for fare increase is too high this year and also in the 5 years, the patronage has been on the decrease for taxis. The number of patronage has dropped from 1.0105 million in 2013 to 898,000 in 2017. In other words, there is a drop of over 110,000 every day. If there is going to be a fare increase, there will be fewer people patronizing taxis. And in fact, the hiring fee for drivers may go up because there will be an incentive for owners to increase fare higher, the higher fee. And so we would object to the application this time around, so that there will not be a drop in the income for drivers as a result of lower patronage and higher fee increase by owners. Okay, members, please cast your vote according to the seat number. Please check your votes. Voting shall now stop and the results are displayed. 16 present, 11 for, 3 against, 1 abstention. The motion is carried. Right, next one. Road safety audit and road safety check. May we ask the administration to come in now? We have paper CB4766-03. In accordance with ROP 83A, if members have direct or indirect pecuniary interests related to the item under discussion today, please disclose that the nature of that interest before you speak. Now you can press the button to indicate your request to speak. If officials have settled down, can we have someone take us through the paper, please? Chairman, members, we'd like to brief members on the road safety audit for new road projects and road improvement works, as well as the road safety check on existing roads implemented by the government for the purpose of enhancing road safety. The road safety audit is done by independent qualified road safety auditors. We will have formal and systematic examination and report on safety performance of road projects. This is different from the normal safety check. This is a preventive measure. At the design and construction stage of transport infrastructure, we will already start to enhance safety performance of roads. The auditors will make use of their professional experience in investigating into accidents, and they will look at the various stages, including planning, design, construction, and pre-opening stages. And in accordance with actual situations, they will propose enhancement measures in order to reduce the chance of driving errors and mitigate the severity of traffic accidents arising from driving errors, so as to create a safer road environment. In four strategic road projects, we have implemented pilot application of road safety audit so that in the design and construction stage, there will be the enhancement of safety performance already. And we would improve the traffic signs and road markings, provision of lay-bys at appropriate locations, reviewing the details of the arrangement of safety barriers and road edge markings to strengthen road protection. In view of the effectiveness of the pilot schemes, the TD has required that starting from the 1st of April 2019, departments must carry out road safety audit at various stages of all new road projects, namely the Hiram's Highway improvement and the widening of Castle Peak Road, Castle Peak Bay projects, which are under design, and the Tuen Mun Chatlakot Link project, which is under construction. According to the new arrangement, works departments must deploy independent auditors equipped with specialized knowledge to conduct road safety audit. The auditors must have completed professional training on road safety audit and possess practical experience in such audit work. Also, the TD will draw up a strategy and also develop the relevant system and detailing the various procedures. And then there will be a list of such or inventory list of road safety auditors. And starting from 2017, together with the Highways Department, on roads where the speed limit is 70, the TD has conducted an examination of road safety. With the work coming to an end, the accident rate on all roads in Hong Kong has been on the decrease.
In order to enhance the road safety, the Highways and Transport Department, I have started a two-year consultancy study to review all the roadside safety hazards in Hong Kong. Depending on the traffic condition, the department will be mapping out the policies in this regard. The TD and the highways will look at the results, and they will be implementing all the enhancement measures progressively. The consultant will also look at the latest development in other jurisdictions and identify suitable locations for pilot trial. We are happy to listen to members' views in relation to road safety. There are 10 members who have pressed the button to speak. We're here till 11:30 for this particular item, 3 minutes. Michael Tien, Colin Bo, Jeremy Tam, Tony J, Yu Xi Wing, Ching Chong Tai, Ray Chen, Gary Fan, Michael Look, and Felix Chung. Anybody else? If so, please press the button. I'm going to draw a line there. Mr. Michael Tien, two questions, if I may. And the first one is quality. The second one is the average speed. When it comes to road safety, the most important thing is the road is sufficiently safe, and it should be sufficiently well serviced. In Lung Chong Road, in some cases there are potholes and the portal areas of the Hong Kong Tunnel, and the $36 billion Central Wan Chai Bypass is also experiencing uneven surfaces. We have an expert here, Mr. J. Now, with the uneven road surface, which gives rise to noise pollution, we also have light pollution and so on. How bad is the, or has the Thus, the road surface has to be uneven before you would rectify them. And second, the average speed, Chairman, all these speed detector is a waste of time. Everybody knows where they are. We have prior knowledge of their presence. People will be slowing down when they'll be speeding away after they've gone past the speed detector, and this would result in higher noise pollution. I think the best thing is to have the speed detection on the basis of a zone, and that would deter people from speeding, because right now they will slow down when they drive past the detector, and then they will be speeding away. On the 30th of January, in my written query, you said that this would be trialed, and on the 28th of February, you said that you would be putting this into trial. So how many speed detectors are there in Hong Kong, and how many of them can be converted into a zonal kind of detection? Yes, Undersecretary. A road service, I defer to my colleagues. Right, I'd like to hear from Mr. Cheng, because he's very much an expert. Mr. Cheng, thank you very much. And Mr. Tan, uneven road service. We do have a design standard when it comes to new roads. The Highways Department will have to follow these guidelines when fixing the roads. When roads have been used for some time, there would be wear and tear. Yes, there is an uneven surface. Right, I think you have to follow up on other occasions. Chairman, what about the speed detector? Yes, make it quick, please. Mr. Yang? Yes, we'll start looking at the detector. We'll pick a suitable road and look at average speed. Ms. Claudia Mo, why don't you let him finish? I thought you would let him finish. I'm calling upon you to speak. Thank you. Right, road safety. What about the problem of road raising, car raising in the early morning, the pre-dawn raising, Meifu and Kwantung bypass? Are you going to install more speed detector, or are you going to deploy more police presence to ambush them? On Nathan Road, it is very, very congested. With the low speed, the safety may not be at risk. But when vehicles are turning into Nathan Road and a 90-degree turn, the private cars sometimes have to avoid the buses, and there may be accidents happening. Are you going to erect more crash barriers to prevent these kind of crash? Also, you have this energy absorbing bollard, the EAB imported from Australia. I think the more you have this installed, the better. Australia has been having these for a long time. At Tin-Wan Prior Road and Tai Lam Tunnel Bus Interchange, and you have all these bollards. Where else are you going to have these energy absorbing bollard? TD, Mr. Yao. Thank you, Madam Mo. This energy absorbing bollard, we just installed them. The response so far has been pretty good. If this proves to be a success, then we will consider installing them at high speed places, such as, other than Tai Lam and Tin Wan, there are other locations that would be suitable. What about Long Chong Road? We'll be looking at these. We do have some criteria, like as traffic speed. How many devices do you have, and how many locations are you considering? We have the first batch. How many? About a dozen, half a dozen or so have been installed at Tin 1. We will identify locations for further installation. Yes, about the speed limit, pre-dawn car racing, we have some stationary speed detector. We also have mobile detectors, which will be administered by the police, and the zonal detection. This is being tried out. I'm going to draw a line there. Mr. Jeremy Tam, Chairman, thank you. Now, for this speed detector, who's going to decide where to install them? We do have a meeting with the police to see who is going to be suitable. Outside Laguna City, outside the on the Kwantung Bypass, car racing is happening quite a lot. We wrote to the police, and they said they would be mounting inspection, and I hope that you will have a look at that particular location. According to the paper, you have conducted some road safety check, and since 2007, things have improved. Accident rate has come down, 25.5 in 2008, coming down to 20.5 in 2018. That's the figure for the accident rate. But what about roads that are more than 70 kilometers per hour? Do you have any accident rate? That's paragraph 14 of the paper. Yes, we have the figures for the whole of Hong Kong. Now, this is the figure for the licensed vehicles. This is a downward trend. We also have the number of vehicles per million. Well, sorry, I have to interject here. Now, you review the road safety measures for roads with a speed limit of 70 kilometers per hour. The accident rate has come down. That's for roads with a speed limit of 70 or above. Now, the fact that it is coming down, it may not be because you've done something about the road with a speed limit of 70 kilometers or above. But statistically, it doesn't make any sense. It doesn't matter if you don't have the figures. You might wish to supplement the information afterwards. And if you can do so in writing, please. Para 18, there is a speed limit review working group, the police, Hong Kong Automobile Association, Institute of Advanced Motorists are involved. You don't have any representatives from the professional drivers. The AA, the Institute of Advanced Motorists. My understanding is that they cover the motorcycles and private cars. What about goods vehicles, tractors, and lorries in general? Thank you. Yes, the two associations. AA covers private cars, but the Institute of Advanced Motorists do have members from the professional drivers. Mr. Tony J, road safety is a must. If you build the roads, they're not safe, then it doesn't make sense. This road safety audit doesn't mean that you would retain consultants. You also have engineers and experts from the transport department looking at this. And definitely the roads will be safe. Is it the case that you are losing confidence in the road safety, and you're commissioning somebody else to do the auditing? Is it a duplication of work? Second, you are emphasizing safe use of the roads, be it motorists and pedestrians. That this administration is people-oriented. And we're not simply talking about the passengers or the pedestrians. We're talking about the impact, like noise impact that will be caused to the residential dwellings along the road. If you build a road which is there to serve people, and subsequently you have to install or retrofit noise enclosure, why don't you include this? Third, like Mr. Michael Tin said, you're covering planning, construction, and the pre-opening stages. And after the road has been commissioned, you don't seem to put an emphasis on the repair and maintenance. After torrential downpour, you get to see that there is a lot of wear and tear. How are you going to deal with this? How do you check and review the situation? I'm sure by convention, you would be deploying teams to inspect them. Oh, there are so many roads in the road. You don't have any smart devices to monitor the state of repair on our roads. And for planning, do you simply consider the safety of the project and not putting sufficient emphasis on the necessity of people? Mr. Yao from the TD, right? I defer the third question to my colleague. Now, road safety audit is conducted in a systematic manner. The same is done in overseas jurisdiction. They have a checklist for them to do it. They are done by independent people. There may be the engineers are doing their own stuff. It would be good enough for independent auditor to check it. Well, if that's the case, everything will have to be checked by an auditor. Will there be any duplication of work? Right, any duplication? The auditors are involved in the traffic accident investigation and study, and the perspective would be different. Mr. Yu-Si-Wei, I'd like to raise the question about the coaches. Now, when there are too many coaches going to a certain destination, they will be parked two or three deep. Avenue of Star is a case in point. Ho Kha Wan is another case in point. There are so many coaches that are parked at two or three deep.
Residents and tourists have to make their way in between coaches, and that is very dangerous. A few days ago, there was a resident who was knocked down and who died by a coach. So I'd like to ask you, whether at tourist spots where there are many tourists, whether are you going to do any assessment in order to improve parking of coaches and also keeping order? When we go to the districts, district councillors and even ourselves who are stakeholders would like the administration to regulate the situation. If you only rely on the police to enforce the law, you are not going to solve the problem, because the police cannot be stationed at a spot all the time. If the audit reports that you are talking about can make proposals, for example, if you can build new coach parking spaces in the vicinity of tourist spots, and if you can even provide meters, coaches will not have to park on the carriageways. Transport Department. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Yu. You are talking about existing roads, and this will come under road safety check, which will look at safety of existing roads. As for coaches in Toh Kwa Wan, we know that our traffic engineers in that district are talking to district councillors and other groups. As Mr. Yu said, we are trying to identify roadside and other parking spaces, and we may be improving certain junctions so as to make it safer for that district. Chairman, if you are doing any study, do you have a timetable? Because this has not happened just for half a year or a year. It has been with us for a few years. Of course, the police has been good in drawing up a charter for people to follow, but this is only good for the short term. If you can have long-term planning, can you give me a timetable and can you give a certain concrete proposals so everybody can follow them? Well, this is exactly what they are doing. They are looking at improving the roads and identifying parking spaces. It depends on the final proposals to be made. Well, if they are going to be of a large scale, then it will take longer. Do you have a timetable? Well, they're working on it. I do not know of any detailed timetable. Dr. Chen Chung-tai, thank you, Chair. You are proposing to do this, and it's something new. Are you going to do it according to districts? Or are you going to do it for different types of vehicles or types of licenses, like local licenses or people who also possess a license to drive on the mainland? Remember, in the last 2-3 weeks on Tai Chung Kiu Road in Sha Tin, there have been so many traffic accidents. People have said that this is because there are left or right turn arrows attached to the three light system, and it is said that you have no intention to change the design of such traffic lights. I'd like to ask you about the design of traffic lights. When you do the review, what conditions do you need in order to improve on these lights and the controversy that it is giving rise to? And I'm talking about types of licenses. This is because from 2014 to 2019, this type of licenses, I'm talking about mainland licenses, having been used in Hong Kong, that has increased from 2,500 to 4,200. And also the irregularities that have been committed have risen from 414 to 752 starting in 2014. So I'm talking about these cross-boundary drivers. In the last few months, it is said that in Wan Chai, a car was captured on the in-vehicle camera that they were actually making a turn on pavements. And also, they can turn into a lane where there is head-on traffic. And also, somebody actually turned into a staircase at a Hong Kong-China ferry terminal. Mr. Yao? This road safety audit is not done on the basis of the types of vehicles. We base the audit on roads, and we are going to look at all roads in Hong Kong. If it is a new road, it will be subject to an audit. And if there will be updating or improvement works on roads, the audit will also apply. But the check, the road safety check, will apply to existing roads. We would see where we can make proposals to enhance the safety limit. As for these traffic lights which have a left turn arrow, we are aware of the situation on Tai Chung Kiu Road. Well, this is actually quite commonly used in overseas countries, and it is also used in many places in Hong Kong. Well, what has happened on Tai Chung Kiu Road is such that it has involved many commercial drivers, involving green light buses and also residential coaches. In fact, last year we have started to look at the entire Tai Chung Kiu Road from all aspects, including the design of the road, and we have made improvement proposals. What about people driving in Hong Kong and who possess mainland licenses? Well, please line up again. I'd like to remind Mr. Frankie Yik and Mr. Ao Nok Hin, sorry, you will not have a chance because I have already drawn a line before you press the button. Mr. Ray Chen, can I go to para 7 about the energy absorbing bollards? You say in the paper that this can protect people who wait for buses on the roadside. I think the public will embrace this proposal, but according to the paper, you are just trying them out at the present stage. I'd like to know when you will complete the trial. You say if the trial results are satisfactory, you will examine implementing such measures at other appropriate locations. In other words, it seems you do not intend to install these at most bus stops in Hong Kong. And what are the criteria for you to select appropriate locations? Will you consider bans and downhill slopes first. It's a good concept. It warrants our support, but we want to know the cost effectiveness. And how many such bollards do you have to erect for one bus stop, and how much will it cost? Is it for highways? RTD, Mr. Yao? Thank you. We are starting the trial just now. We will apply the following criteria. First, the bus stop is on a high-speed road, and also that the road design warrants concern, say for example, is at a bend or on a downhill slope. Since we are still conducting the trial and we have to order these from Australia, we have done that in Tin Wan, and each bollard is costing $20,000. But if we go for more locations, I believe there will be the economy of scale and the cost will go down. What do you mean by subject to trial results? Are you saying that a bus should crash into these bollards and the bollards have prevented any accident or injury? Do you call that satisfactory? Well, if there are accidents, of course, we will avail ourselves to the accident figures, but we are not going to wait for an accident to happen. By trial results, we want to say that the distance between bollards has to be decided. Of course, if they are closer together, there will be more protection, but then it will be in the way of passengers getting on and off buses. If there are accident figures, of course, we want to know them. But we believe we will try it out for a quarter or two, and then we can consider installing these at other bus stops. Do you have a plan how many bus stops you will equip with these bollards in the first stage? We are still identifying the bus stops because we have just threshed out the criteria. We have not gone to the stage of having a certain number of bus stops. Mr. Gary Fan? About road safety, you are proposing to do this, which is the hardware side, but how users, how motorists use the road and how you can educate them to use the road, I think that is equally important. Earlier on, there was a report saying that people coming from the mainland can switch to a Hong Kong driver's license without examination, and then they can go to Australia to drive. And then also after the death accident in Tokwa Wan, some NGOs have distributed pamphlets to guide passengers or pedestrians how they should use the roads. But this should have been done by the administration and also the FHB in a reply to Mr. Andrew Wen's written question. 400,000 people in the last few years have got a Hong Kong driver's license without examination, and out of those, 280,000 have been from the mainland. And this figure is going up year on year. Therefore, I'm extremely worried about people getting a Hong Kong driver's license without examination and how they are using the roads in Hong Kong, because as you know, we have different designs, different signages, and in fact, we drive on the right side and they don't. So apart from these improvements proposed for the hardware side, have you or are you considering measures in order to tackle problems which may arise from people who get Hong Kong's driver's license without examination, so there will not be accidents caused by them? Will you do more education, and also will you consider tightening up the measures to or for the issue of Hong Kong's driver's license? Will you enhance the threshold for application, for example? Mr. Yao, right? TD? There are different factors causing accidents, people, the road, and the vehicles. And now accidents are mainly caused by people. Well, and I mean motorists. 80 to 90% of accidents are caused by motorists or people who are injured. Very often they keep too close, they tailgate people, and also vehicles can lose control. Now, how can we change people's behavior so they place more emphasis on safety? We need to update the laws and we need to enforce the law, but the most important thing is to do education and publicity. The TD and the police are working through the Hong Kong Road Safety Council. No, you are telling me what you are doing, but I'm asking you for new ideas. And I think there are a few questions, but I don't think you can really answer them here, including people who come to Hong Kong from the mainland and who get a Hong Kong driver's license without examination. Can I have a second round? No, sorry, no. Mr. Michael, look. Thank you, Chair. Three questions. Number one, the LegCo has just been to Hangzhou in Shanghai, and we have used the we have seen the application of big data. And they have this city brain concept which collects data about roads, including the traffic flow, black spots, and also small or minor traffic accidents. When you go about doing your road safety check, do you apply big data analytics in order to enhance road safety? Secondly, I also like to mention the energy absorbing bollards, where the technology has come from Australia. Many netizens are saying that the cost is rather expensive, since it's $20,000 for one. Is it because it has any kind of high technology embedded in it so that it costs so much? Or is it because you are ordering a small number so it's expensive? At any bus stop which measures dozens of meters, it would be already quite expensive for you to fit out one bus stop. Is it that you can really reduce the price when you go for it in a larger scale? Number three, I like to see whether we unions can take part in the speed limit working group. Can you formally invite commercial driver union representatives, because they are on the road every day? They are more conversed with the road situation more than anybody else. So I hope you have heard me.
Take a break after this to proceed next door to vote. Mr. Yao, yes, big data. Road safety audit is about the examination of the roads and identify areas for improvements. In our strategic roads, we are retrofitting some detectors, and this will be completed next year. And with this completion, we will look at the speed, the signaling, and the broken down vehicles and so on. We do have a lot of data. Now, for the energy absorbing bollard, this is costing us $20,000 per bollard. Now, for the conventional bollards, impact would injure the passengers. For this energy absorbing bollard, it would shift a little bit upon impact, and it would absorb the impact, and the drivers and the passengers will not suffer that serious injury. And for the review committee, we will have a look at the membership. Right, PwC is voting. We'll take a break for 5 minutes.